are you waving at us to start?
Thank you. made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Aren't you glad to be back?
Amen.
This beautiful place, for some of us it's been far, far too long since we were able to be inside these walls, and the prelude was most appropriate for today. We are on holy ground, and we give God thanks. I want to just say a couple of words that will need to be said as we begin. First of all, I appreciate all of you. You're wearing the mask and doing the things that you've been asked to do for us to be able to worship. And I pray that your efforts will both protect you as well as the people who worship in the building today with you. I thank you for all of your efforts, your prayers, and everything that you've done to help us keep the wheels turning. And some people have really worked very, very hard behind the scenes. I remind you that we have trash cans at both entrances, and please, if you have any papers or anything that need to be discarded, please place those in the trash cans as you leave. Also, the offering boxes, there's one in that entrance of the church and one here at this entrance of the church. Thank you for your faithfulness. It means so very, very much. And most of all, just let's just enjoy this wonderful opportunity that God has given us. It's different. And we're learning a lot of things as we go along with all of this. And things will be changing, I suspect, week from week. But let's just do our best. Give God all praise and glory. I was so happy to see the children this morning. One of the young men came up to me and I said, hello, Pastor Amos. And I had my mask on, and I said, how do you know who I am? He said, you're the only one that wears those clothes. Well, what a wonderful day. Let's worship the Lord in the spirit of truth and in the beauty of his holiness.
Come thy fountain, every blessing. So let's hear some heavenly hymn.
Come thy fountain, every blessing.
Through
the
tears,
tears.
As we go to the Lord in prayer, as you well know, there are many of our brothers and sisters who are going through some very difficult times in their life right now. And we want to remember them to the Lord as we pray. And I know you come through these doors with different ones on your heart, different situations. The good news is that with God, all things are possible. And that he invites us to come, bring our prayer, bring our petition to him. He really cares. He cares about what's on your heart and who is on your heart. And I hope that we will feel a sense of bringing these people and these situations to God in confidence. I would like to give you a bit of good news. I understand as of yesterday, little baby Birdie is now 3 pounds and 4 ounces. We're just delighted to know that, and she's not required oxygen, and we're just giving God thanks for what's going on in her life. I also know that some of you are hurting, and God cares about you. Let's pray. Precious Lord, we know that you've been with us through this pandemic as we've tried to move along with life and make the best of it that we can. But Lord, you made us as a people who need each other. From the very beginning, you said it was not good that we would be alone. Now we're able to be back together, a small group of us at this time, more to come. And we love standing here in this place, sitting in these pews, seeing the sun shine through these windows and hearing the music. We give you thanks. It's a reminder to us, your word that is true, that when all the storms are over, you will still be who you are, and we will still be loved. Thank you for your faithfulness to us, and forgive us for the times that we have been less than faithful to you. We come here because we're drawn to this place. We come because someone hung on a cross for us, our Savior Jesus. We've come to say thank you for our redemption and for blessings untold. We've come to cry out to you, Lord. Hear us, we need you. Someone's hurting today. Please touch those eyes that are filled with tears. Replace the tears with the comfort of your presence. And those who are worried and trying to make sense of life right now, oh God, I pray that you help them and you help the ones who are helping them. We pray for those who are sick in body and those who are sick in soul. We pray for a broken world that we might be able to somehow present the one that we know is the answer in a way that is truly believable and in a way that will cause others to come to you and love you. Lord, bless, as only you can do, each and every need. Receive our thanksgiving and our praise. Heal us, O hand of God, as we continue to pray the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 20, beginning with verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into the vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing in idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. And when he went out again about noon, and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. At about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around and said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers together and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." And when those who were hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled at the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual day's wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first song I would like to sing for you is "In the Garden." I thought of this, especially in light of our time spending out inside the church in the garden. I think of the verse that says, "His voice is so sweet that birds hush their sleep." And I thought about, you know, that mockingbird is on the wire up in the corner there. He was always so quiet listening to what was the word that's being said. And I think the quaint word of Jesus being there is the same thing. So we'll see what we can do with this song. Try to do it without a compliment. See what happens.
I come to the garden alone.
is well with my soul. You know, if you live long enough, there's going to be some kind of tragedy and sorrow that occurs in our lives. And I was thinking about what lifts us up, what holds us together. And if you can say, it is well with my soul. In Jesus' name. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow my sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul.
You know, there is a phrase that we hear once in a while in the church. We've never done it this way before. And that really may be a compliment for the church that we're about to do something finally God's way. That maybe we're finally just letting go and hearing God say, there is a better way and another way that I expect you to do this. This passage of scripture is one that will stir up some controversy. It's one that at least will get some discussion in Sunday school. You have this man who needs some people working in his vineyard, and he goes out early in the morning and he finds some people in that usual place where you gather if you're looking for a job, hoping that someone will ride by and hire you for the day. And there's usually a lot of people there. We still have such places around where people gather knowing that maybe a contractor needs an extra hand during the day, and they'll drive by and say, I need you and you and you come. And usually the person is very, very happy to be able to at least have a job for another day and make a little bit of money, maybe take care of the needs of the house as much as he can. And that's kind of what's going on in the text. They hire these people. We'll give you a denario, a daily's wage. They agree. They're happy to get the job. They're so happy. And then an hour later, they hire some more that are there. And as the day goes on, I don't know if there's problems at work or what's going on, but the landowner realizes that he needs more help, and so he goes and he finds more people and brings them in, and finally they're down to the last hour, and apparently there's more work that needs to be done. He goes to that place and he finds a few people standing there. Why are you standing here, he asks, and their answer is, no one has hired us. And he says, well, I'm hiring you now. Come, and I'll give you a fair wage if you'll go and help. I've got some work that needs to be finished. And so they go and they work an hour with people who've been working all day long. And then it comes payday, or pay time. They're paid each day in the evening. And the landowner says, pay those who've only worked an hour, pay them first. Now that just didn't make a whole lot of sense. He could have kept down a lot of grumbling if he had waited till last. Nobody would have known. But then this is Jesus' story, not mine. And he tells it this way because there's something he wants us to hear and to know. So they pay the ones who just work an hour, a full day's wage. The others who are lined up thinking, like we would probably think, wow, if he works just an hour and gets a full day's wage, I've been working 11 hours. Just think what I'm going to get. And they realize pretty quick that what you're going to get is the same thing he got. That'll cause some grumbling, won't it? That's just not the way we do things. And isn't that one of the points that Jesus is making? I came into this world to show you that there is another way of doing things. A better way. But that's just not fair. Is it? Would we call that fair? We don't like things like that, not even in the church. We want everything a certain way. There was an evangelist years ago named Gypsy Smith, who was a gypsy and felt a call to God and was quite effective in his evangelism efforts. But his ways were not like anyone else's. They were crude, they were strange. People wanted him to be their pastor, but they wanted him to kind of polish it up a little bit. And his words were always this: I was born out in the field with the wild flowers. You're not going to put me in a flower pot. You see, isn't that what we do in the church sometimes? We want to get everything in the flower pot. And the truth is, we who sit in these pews, most of us are still a bit of wild flowers, aren't we? God has ways that are not the way we normally do things. Pat and I like to watch one of the very few television shows that's good that's left on the air. Wheel of Fortune. And we're not into it very long until we decided who really ought to get bankrupt. We decided who we want to see win. And it just picks at us when somebody's just dominating it, winning all the money, and it's not the one we like. And then there are those occasions when the one that we really like, that poor lady who's a youth worker at her church, and she looks so bored, next to her is somebody you know makes a lot of money, and you don't like them anyway. And she's doing pretty good, making big money, and she's finally got all the letters on her. Anybody can read it now. And she says, I'll go one more time. And you know what happens? Bankrupt. And who's standing beside her? Who's next? Eager Beaver, the one you didn't want to get it. It's not fair. She did all the work. He doesn't even spin the wheel. And he gets all the work that she has done, all the wages of it. Now that's just a game show, I know. But don't we go at life sometimes as though I deserve some things that other people don't? You know, when we compare ourselves to try to make ourselves look like we think we are, we always seem to compare ourselves to people who we think are less than we are, not more. We have that way of standing in line. If we had been in this story, wouldn't we have grumbled at the grace of God too? If we'd been the one who worked all day long, and then someone comes along and works just an hour, wouldn't we have grumbled also? Isn't it wonderful that we cannot manipulate the grace of God? A person came to the church one day. It wasn't this church, but it could have been. It could be any church. The person was needing some help. They received the help. As they were leaving, another person was coming in. A person that was an active member of the congregation, and I liked very much. But that person saw what was going on, and I told them that we gave them a little help. And the question was, and there's not a pastor around, it's been a pastor very long, that hasn't heard these words. The question was, or not the question, but the statement, I hope they were worthy. Or was that person worthy? My answer will always be no. No. And neither are we worthy to give it, but God lets us. You see, that's the whole point of the text. It's not about who's entitled. It's not about who deserves. It's not even about who's worthy. This text is about a God who is good and a God who is filled with grace and a God who sees things that we don't see and who responds in ways that we would not agree, but in ways that are best and ways that are right. We just need to learn to be able to see it. Do you know how hard it is to stand in an unemployment line and not get hired? Do you know what it's like to get up at the break of dawn and go downtown and stand in a location and just hope and pray that somebody will come by and pick you up and give you a day's work so you can buy some milk or diapers for the baby? What if you stand there all day long? The other workers in the field think, well, those sorry things, they've not done anything all day. I suspect that those who have been standing there hoping and praying in their hearts have worked as hard as anyone. I have great respect for those who were still there at 5 o'clock. Most people would have gone home and given up. But talk about hope. Talk about praying and believing. Maybe there's a chance yet. You see, God sees those kinds of things when we don't. God is good. He wanted us to have this text in the Bible because it's not the way we live our lives in this world. It's not the way of society, but it is the way of the kingdom of God. He wants us to understand that there's far more to it than what we have earned in life. How many of us, we know the feeling of giving our best and watching someone only go at it halfway, and yet they get all the credit. They get all the awards. They get all the attention. And life isn't fair. Do you know what led to this parable? There was a rich young man that came to Jesus and inquired of him what he must do to have eternal life. And you know the conversation. Here's a rich young man who's been obedient to God, who's done all the things that religion has required. He's done well in society. He's the one who anyone would want. If you're on a campaign for church members, you sure don't turn this one away. But Jesus did. Not because he wanted to, but because that young man came to reality when he came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, sell what you have, get rid of it all, forget about it, give it to the poor, and come, go with me. I have a feeling this man was so used to being accepted for who he was in society, he wasn't ready for this. And I doubt that he really understood what Jesus was saying to him. Jesus was saying, I love you without all that stuff. It's not your stuff that I want, it's your heart. I want you. The man went away because he wasn't ready for that. You see, that's the thing with the gospel. It all seems to fit so well until you come across a story like this. Those disciples around Jesus, they watched what he did with the rich young ruler, and they started to tell Jesus all the things that they had. We left everything to go with you. What about us? Jesus just told them about leaving things, hardships, difficulties in life, even his crucifixion. It's almost like, what about us? The world will think you get cheated. It will look like you get cheated. You will feel like you've been cheated. But hold on. When payday comes, you will see that God is good. We think this is not fair until it's our story. And we've squandered away our life, most of it, and we finally come to know God. And he loves us just as much as he's loved anyone else in this world. Maybe that's not fair. But God's not worried about that. That's not what he's about. That's not who he is. It is a God who says, even if you come to me on your last breath, you get paid a full day's wage. Isn't that good news? I give God thanks that he's teaching us that there is a better way than society offers. This is a place where we all come because we're all sin sick and troubled and broken. Anyone here who hasn't made some mistakes? Anyone here who hasn't sinned? What hour did we come? Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift of love. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
last verse, verse 19, in the King James Version, there is a sentence that you will not find in the modern versions that we have. And I know the reason why, and that's okay, but I still like it. I think it really kind of sums it all up. It says, many are called, but few are chosen. You see, that's the good news of the gospel. We don't have to worry about the wage at the end of the day. The joy is, the reason we should be happy today, and I know that we are, is that we have been called and we have been chosen by God. Isn't that enough?
Amen.
The blessings of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and forevermore. Hallelujah.